So happy to see you. Thank you.
I wouldn't have missed it.
And the chair. And Ezekiel will stand for you.
No. Yes.
Oh, thank you.
And I wouldn't be such a proud mother if I didn't give you this one too, because my son loves the last chapter. It's not in this one.
Oh, thank you.
So I thought perhaps you
would. I understand completely.
I think you would. I thought you would, but I apologize for doing that in excess. But
No. Thank you very much.
I have my daughter Maureen. She comes here. She leaves the book here. When she comes here, she picks up from me your book on Russia, the
Firebird.
Firebird, yes. I always get confused with the title.
I'm glad you read it. I'm very honored that you both read it.
Oh.
Well, she's fascinated. Maureen said to tell you that she's up to Catherine the Great now.
Well, as I said, I think she's better in the sense of heart. So tell her to please proceed on.
Oh, she will.
Because I really wrote that book with an idea that it had stepping stones to get you to the middle. And then it all was supposed to come together for you so that you then could go on to the whole 19th century. So, and I think it basically works, but I had to be much more brief in the beginning in order to do that, to give you those stepping stones that you need. Well, anyway, happy to see you today.
Yeah, happy to see you. How are
good
you?
See you.
And I want to know, where is that log cabin you hide in?
Well,
I see you.
How are you?
Good.
Good to see you.
John, come. And Russell, come on up here and sit down. First of all, before we get down to the business of the day, bless you for all the work and effort on that tax reform, and I know you're working on it now for the debate on the floor. But I want to intervene with another one right now. It has to do with Saudi arms. And Russell Lee, I know there's a lot of misunderstanding on the Hill about this and about the Saudis and everything, but good Lord, they have been most reliable. Granted, they have to say some things out front because of their Arab connections. But for example, when Gaddafi wanted to call an Arab League meeting and bounce us for the Tripoli raid, they quashed it. The Saudis stopped it. And they've been a pretty staunch Mideast ally of this country for about 40 years, but right now under the king, they're really doing just fine. In fact, Gaddafi has said they're now licking our boots because they stopped him on that drive. And this thing of the arms, they can get those arms. Please be seated. And thank you all for coming down today. I want to importantly thank you for all your fine work in getting a tax reform bill reported in your committee by a unanimous vote. It's got to be almost the first, at least for a long time. You've truly been doing America's business, and he's been doing it brilliantly, and as far as I'm concerned, you're now the A-team. This bipartisan spirit, I think, will be a tremendous boost in creating a binding commitment to the only special interest that counts, and that's the American people, the ones who pay the bills in this country. And in particular, I want to thank you for eliminating needless brackets and lowering the rates to 15% and 27%. Raising the personal independence exemption to $2,000 for middle and low-income Americans, and providing a minimum tax so that individuals and corporations will pay their fair share. Merrill and his group at the Council of Economic Advisors tell me that the added incentives and efficiencies could increase America's growth rate nearly 10% over the next decade. And that means people will be able to keep more of what they earn and thereby encouraging the entrepreneurial spirit, building a stronger, more productive economy. And that kind of growth would also, it is estimated, provide an additional 4 million new jobs over that same period. You and your chairman, Bob Packwood, who couldn't be with us today, are to be commended for a yeoman effort. You breathe new life into something that had been declared dead on more than one occasion since the effort has begun. And now we need to make sure the lifeline stays intact as this historic measure is considered with a full Senate when you get back from Memorial Day recess. Not only will the American people benefit by your straightforward, hard-hitting proposal to return simplicity and fairness to the tax code, but the bipartisan coalition you forged is a major victory for the democratic process that makes this nation great. And I think the American people join me in thanking you for your statesmanship in this. And now, Jim Baker, here.
I can't get to my seat, Mr. President.
Well, take off from there. That's a pretty good podium.
President, what do you think about using the surplus for the deficit first year?
Helen,
have you made up your mind on it?
I'm going to wait until we have the discussion here that will follow. Unfortunately, you all will have business elsewhere.
You want to answer the Saudi stinger question now, Mr. President?
No, I don't.
Are you going to take the sting out of the Saudi package?
This is the news subject now.
Let's go. Thank you.
Thank you. This way.
I have just come from a meeting this morning with a whole bunch of kids on the drug program, the Just Say No program, and that same question. They come in here with a subject of taxes, and they want to tell them, they're not going to dictate what's news.
Hang tough.
Just say no. Well, Jim.
Mr. President, the only thing I would add is that I know I don't have to suggest to this committee that the pressures are going to be great as we move to the Senate floor, and for those of us who went through this experience in the House, I suppose we appreciate just how great. I think it's really important that we all focus on moving this through the Senate floor with as little change as possible, and doing so as rapidly as possible. And the Majority Leader and I had a discussion of this effect this morning. That's really all I have to add to what you had to say, sir.
Well, there are a number of heroes here as far as tax reform is concerned. In both the parties, and some were there every day in the core group, and I regret Senator Packwood cannot be here, but I think we all know he has a primary election. It's a matter of some interest to him. So he is in Oregon. He will win. But I talked with him last Thursday. He would like to bring the bill up as quickly as we can when we're back here. We do have to get a budget waiver of some kind.
Mr. Driver?
Yes. Hello there.
Mr. President.
How are you?
Oh? I'm Mr. President. Good to see you, sir.
Good to see you.
This is Dr. Harry Smith.
Well, how are you? Nice to see you. Well, come in here.
Nice to see you. Nice to meet you.
Nice to see you look like yourself.
Only better.
Thank you.
It's difficult to drive us, huh?
I had a pleasure reading your book. A fellow senator friend of mine gave it to me.
Did you really?
Quite some time ago when I read it, yes. As a matter of fact, at that time I got on the White House doctor as to why he didn't talk to somebody over at FDA and he never had much success.
Mr. President, I had no intentions of talking on this subject, but we've given power to the FDA greater than the Supreme Court has, the power of life and death, and we don't even know who they are, and they've got tenure, and they play their own games. It's what you were talking about 6 years ago about bureaucracy. They do anything they want to do.
Yeah.
And, but anyhow, that's... Barry, let me show you something. Give me something. I just wanted to show you something, Mr. President. I'm starting for a peculiar...
Greetings can come later. We've got to get at this. I'm sorry to interrupt you.
They've just done my punch line.
Please, sit down. Don't let this scare you here. I just don't want to forget anything. Did you want to finish something?
I was just commenting finally on the stinger point. And first of all, there were those who said that if it weren't for the stinger, they'd be with us. So the stinger isn't in the package. And second, there are those who said, I voted what I thought about the package, but now I'm not voting so much on the package, I'm voting on whether or not to sustain, to support the President of the United States. But I need to have a reason to change something in the picture that's different, and there's something different. So those were the 2 points on that last question.
All right, well, listen, thank you all for coming here, and I'm very proud, I want to say in advance, that this administration of ours has been characterized by officials in Israel up to the Prime Minister as being the truest friend that Israel has ever had. And I value that reputation for us very much, and we'll never do anything to jeopardize it. Indeed, our entire Middle East policy rests upon the premise of a strong Israel. And with regard to things of arms of this kind, I have repeatedly made it plain to them that we will never do anything that will allow anyone to get a qualitative advantage over Israel's defensive capability. And I appreciate everything that you've done the past 5 years to strengthen the relationship between our country and Israel. I think it's now so strong and so important to both peoples that it mustn't be diminished. And because of our commitment to that security, I want to go on why I think the Saudi arms sale is important, and actually important to Israel's welfare. A coherent foreign policy is impossible if the Congress intrudes on the traditional executive prerogatives. Congressional action on this arms sale threatens my ability to formulate and carry out the policies needed to support our interest in the Middle East. In fact, it significantly erodes the perception of the strong U.S. leadership as a member of the peace process itself. The picture of a country, and remember that in order, if we're to have a voice and be able to persuade the countries of the Middle East, Israel and the Arab nations, to come together as Israel and Egypt did in a peace. The Arab nations, they know of our alliance with Israel, but they have got to be able to see that we can be a friend of theirs too, and that we can be fair in anything that we present. And with regard to the security of Israel now, everything in this sale, if you haven't been told already, is already in the Saudi inventory, won't affect them military balance in the Middle East, and certainly it won't endanger Israel's security. And that's why Prime Minister Peres, I will say here, I will never go out and say this publicly, Prime Minister Peres has assured us that it would be impossible, while technically a state of war exists between those other nations and Israel, to support such a thing. He's not opposed to this. It gives him no problems whatsoever. Now, if my veto is not upheld, then it's not only the way we look and the appearance that we've given to the Arab states there of not being dependable, but I lose leverage, because then they see me as someone who can't come through on the things that he may propose. And there's no question but that some of the moderate state, Israel states that we have been trying to work with regard to a peace process have some security needs of their own because of the radical regimes in the region that are violently opposed to the state of Israel and declared enemies of the West. And our friend Gaddafi is one of those. And I don't know, you probably are aware of this, scholars in this field, but when we talk about radical regimes, for example, Gaddafi's great goal, as we know, is the Islamic world revolution or the Islamic fundamentalist state. And wherever there are Shiites, Muslims, that is his target, because they're the faction in the Muslim religion that believes that true Islam means a church state of their religion. They believe that Muhammad, before he left this earth, their prophet, was also then the secular head, he was the government. So they believe that that is the goal, that you have what, well, Khomeini has now in Iran. You don't have a secular government, you have this kind of Islamic state. And all of those rulers, King Fahd and all of them, they're looking over their shoulder all the time because every one of them has factions in their own country and give them these problems. Iran is also pushing hard to put a radical Shiite regime in power in Iraq. That's one of the things that's back of their refusal now when Iraq is, even though they started the war, is trying to persuade them to end the war. And I think that Israel and the West would be far more threatened by a fundamentalist regime of that kind in power in Saudi Arabia. Now the issue isn't whether the Saudis get these missiles, it's who they get them from. If the U.S. refuses to supply the legitimate needs, the Saudis have turned to those who show far less concern for Israel's security and who place no controls. We do place controls on the weapons that we sell there. That they know that we will respond and take whatever action is necessary to redress agreements if they should ever turn and use those weapons offensively against anyone.
President?
Hello, Sam Michelle from Boston. President of the American Academy.
Pleasure to meet you.
Nice to see you. Ms. Reagan.
John
Goldberg.
Good to see you.
Thank you.
Ms. Reagan.
Conrad Vance.
Yes, hi. Nice to see you.
Hi, how are you? It's good to see you.
Secretary Treasury.
Nice to see you.
Yes.
Well, hi. Nice to see you.
Oh, really?
Oh, really?
He was.
Yeah.
Oh, really?
Yes, he was.
How are you?
Well,
they
repaired
it.
Hi, how are you?
Yes, hello. Nice to see you.
Needs no introduction?
Well,
how are you? It's very nice of you to do this.
Well, right. Pleased to be
here. How do you
do? I want to know that I'm appreciative of you coming here, and particularly those from the Congress who...
I want everybody to move forward, Pete.
Next to the last day before adjournment. And I think that it's fitting that national observance to the dangers of skin cancer should start on Memorial Day, which is the unofficial beginning of summer. And I think especially all citizens over 50 years of age, I'm getting there. particularly should be called to their attention, and I think it's a good thing that we are doing this.
Before then.
Yes.
Yes. Right.
If he wasn't dark brown, something was wrong.
We have a woman at the the White House, who has the most beautiful skin. And finally, I couldn't resist it much longer. And I finally said to her, "Chris, did you ever get out in the sun?" And she said, "No, I was allergic. I couldn't get out." And I said, "God, I wish I'd been allergic. I wish that when I was growing up, we knew then what we know now."
Yeah.
But she's got the most beautiful.
I thought I had beautiful skin when I was that way too.
Little did you know.
I know I shouldn't tell this, but he was about to football at college. His first days of practice, when they were running plays, and I was a right guard, and you wanted to block your leg with the center's leg in the line. And I kept noticing the coach following behind us, just giggling and laughing. Finally, it dawned on me, it was kind of aimed at me. So I finally said, "Coach, what are you doing?" He says, "The next time you line up, look back at your leg." Well, our center was black, and cross legs in that area of the season, you don't wear any socks. And I looked back. My leg was darker than his. Didn't bother me. Well, thank you all for coming down.
Thank you. Oh, it's a pleasure.
Don't you find, though, that even with all this publicity and everything about soldering, what it does to you, that there are still people? I mean, I look at the news, and there are people lying out there.
Yeah.
Well, I don't know if everybody be able to turn around a nation that has just been a go to the beach and bake.
Well, yeah, but my gosh, there have been so many people and so much publicity. I have a secretary who finally I said I give up. I said all I can say. Yeah.
They just use the sun protective creams, then they can still be on the beach and play tennis and so on. But
they're looking forward to
the tan is important.
The tan, yes, she is. So
no, we can't fight that. We're going to try, but it's going to take a while.
Well, you can get a little tan if they use it. It permits some tanning, doesn't it?
Yeah, well, what is this new thing, these shops or these places where you can now go that have that kind of a box thing?
Yes,
or
no, yeah.
The coffin that you get in?
We're concerned about that.
There you go.
Those are suntan powders.
In other words, they would have the same fades as sun.
Yes.
That's not
We heard about that in the testimony this morning. Very threatening, apparently, those machines.
Yeah.
Because they do that all winter, like up in Wisconsin. Then in the summer, they go with natural sun. Then in the winter, they go back to tan. We're very concerned about that. Watching it for
I'm going to look rather funny white. Most of my life I've had been swimming supermarkets. Going back to those 7 years as a lifeguard.
You were a lifeguard for 7 years?
Yeah.
Oh, terrific.
All the way through, well, not quite all the way, but through the latter part of high school and all of college. I was the only lifeguard 7 days a week, morning until whatever time of night the swimmers decided to go home. The river.
Well, something about you that I didn't. Well, I knew everything.
He saved 78 lives.
Well, that's the next thing I was going to ask.
He didn't tan all the time. He worked a little bit.
There's a log there that anytime he'd save a life, he'd make a mark.
And it's still there?
Yeah.
It's now I guess in the whole era of threat. Thinking pollution and so forth in the river, they've now built a municipal swimming pool, and so the log is at the entrance of the swimming pool.
Oh, that's good. That's funny. Now, do any of those people that you saved try to get in touch with you now that you're present in any way?
Oh, once in a great while, someone, or usually it's someone else says, "You saved my brother," or something of this kind. The reason for the notches is because, to my great shock, when you think, gee, you know, if you pulled this person out, it wouldn't have gone in because they didn't know they were drowning. Then after they get up and they talk to their friends for a little bit and see him looking at you, finally comes over and he says, "Well, you know, I was getting along all the time." It's a man that doesn't know me. The boss came down after I pulled someone out. And he had an axe. And this log washed up by a spring flood or something was there on the ground. And he said, "Look, this is what's going to happen with all of them." "We're going to do this." So he said, "Take the axe." And he said, when they come over and start talking that way, he says, "Start chomping." And he says, "And they want to know what you're doing, just tell them, you're just another notch in the wall." That's what I did. I want to say, though, for the ladies, it was men that were more embarrassed at having to be held.
Sure. It's not so macho.
Yeah.
It was psychological, too. It was a fellow came out. There used to be attendants from the Dixon, what was called the colony, It was the state mental institutions, they were right near our park. And the workers there would come over all the time. So one day they brought him over. He looked like a weightlifter. He was like this, but he was blind. And they would swim out to the end of the pier. We had about a 100-foot pier. And then he was a very clumsy swimmer, not very good. But then they would call to him and direct him for him to swim out. And then you could hang on the framework under the pier there. But the current goes through there. And so once in a while, in the last, and finally, he's coming out and he went way below. And now he's fighting the current, trying to get up to them. And all of a sudden, and I'd seen him, and I thought, well, I never want to go in after somebody that built like that. And all of a sudden, he was gone. Down he went. And I went in. And I really was going to be cautious about approaching him and reaching for that first move. And I touched it. And he was just beating the water as if he was trying to pound it down hard enough to stand on. And everything. And like that, the easiest thing in the world. Just completely relaxed. I turned him around, got a cross chest carry, took him into shore, never made it, and then it dawned on me, of course, being blind. The minute he felt another human hand, it was fine. Someone was there to help him.
It's dramatic. That's dramatic.
Yeah.
Well, I didn't mean to give you a lecture.
Thank you so much for your answer. Thank you very much.
Thank you for your support.
So nice of you to tell me that. Thank you.
Lovely to see you again.
And say hello to everybody.
I will.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.